So today, in honor of the deodorant donations for Alexandra House, we framed everything around sweet smells. So maybe you smelled a little something sweet when you came in. We added a little fragrance to the air in our church today. And maybe you took an extra whiff of coffee or your snacks as you settled in. And there's just something about that sense of smell that creates a warm and welcoming atmosphere. You know, you've heard of realtors, when they're showing a house, they'll bake cookies before people come so that the house smells like home. It smells like a place where people do things like bake cookies and things like that. When I think of good smells, something that jumps to my mind is cartoons from my childhood. You see, if you were a cat named Tom, and you wanted to catch a mouse, let's call him Jerry. Let's call him Jerry. What you would do is you would take a piece of cheese that is orange and triangular and has holes in it, right? Because all cartoon cheese looks like that. And you'd set it out someplace prominently, and then the smell of that cheese would waft through the house, right? And you'd see it. You'd see the little smell smoke thing, right? And it would trail down into the little half circle mouse hole, and where a sleeping Jerry would find this smell intruding his nostrils, and then he'd perk up, and it would, like, he'd float off the ground, right? And the fragrance would be drawing him by the nose, you know, completely out of his own control, and pulling him from his safe home up to the place where the cheese was so that he could be trapped and then, you know, outsmart you and you escape and you'd be in pain. Probably an anvil would fall on your head or something like that at some point. Because that's how cartoons work. And I can't think of any smells that actually literally do that in real life, that grab us and physically pull us. There are things we love, like, you know, when my wife Jenny walks out of the bedroom in the morning and I'm up first and the coffee's already going, she's like, oh, thank you. Because the smell signifies something much better, that I've been taking care of her. But there aren't any smells that actually physically take hold of us. But wouldn't it be great if we had something like that here? Something like that at church. That a smell that was as powerful as the cheese in a Tom and Jerry cartoon, or it's actually, like, it's a thing in all cartoons, pretty much. It's the Mickey Mouse, and it's the apple pie cooling in the window, right? or Scooby-Doo and name it, you know, anything, right? So what if we had something that could draw people in, something so alluring that they could not help but stay away? Wouldn't that be great? Because that's kind of the idea here at Northern Light. We're a new church, and that's the point of new churches, is that we meet new people, connect in new ways, and grow, and include more and more people all the time. So I'm looking for that secret ingredient. That secret ingredient, I don't know, whoever's in charge of snacks, start to be on the lookout. Keep it legal. And include something in the snacks that will draw people in. I don't know what it is, but there is something else altogether that we can't put in our food, that Jesus offers us, that Jesus says has this very same effect. And we heard about it in today's reading from John chapter 13. And I want to talk to you a little bit about that scene that we heard about and what happens there. So this happens the night of the Last Supper, and Jesus is sitting with all the disciples in a room, alone, and he's washed his disciples' feet, and now he's sharing some parting words with them about what to expect, what's going to happen next, and how to live now that Jesus is leaving. Here's kind of what he says. He says, hey everyone, I'm leaving soon, so here's what you have to do. Love one another. If you love one another, then everyone is going to know that you're mine. And then they'll want to be with you. And his disciples are just like, blank expressions. And Peter, who is always the first to talk, says, "Oh, wait, hang on, what? Did you say you're leaving? Did you say you're going away, Jesus?" And Jesus says, "Yes, I'm leaving. Where I'm going, you can't come. Don't worry about that." Because Jesus is saying, "I just told you the secret ingredient. I said if you love one another, then everything else will work out. People will know you belong to me, the Savior, the Messiah, and then the kingdom will grow on earth as it is in heaven. So love one another." And Peter says, "But where are you going?" So Peter says, "Wait, don't leave. I'll give my life for you. I'll die for you. Whatever you want. Just stay. Just anything, but leave. Don't leave." And Jesus says, "Okay, Peter, take it down a notch. Not only won't you die for me just yet, you're going to deny me 3 times before this night's over." That's Jesus' response to Peter's gushing about how much he loves Jesus. Jesus says, "We'll see about that." And isn't that just the place that we find ourselves so often? Knowing that there's just nothing else that we'll do besides loving one another. And yet our own self-interest and our own anxiety keep us away from loving the way that we know that we should. Jesus has left this secret ingredient for us. The secret ingredient for creating lives that are so beautiful and so attractive that they allure others into this community of love. But in the end, we don't often love as well as we should. We take, we might talk a good game. I'm really good at that, talking a good game, because I'm wearing the mic on my head. But we don't show up when it counts. Too often we don't show up when it counts. And I'm just as guilty as anyone else of not loving well enough. On Sunday mornings, it happens a lot. You might say hi to me and you can tell I'm saying hi to you, but my brain is sitting at the soundboard and my brain is fixing something. And I want to apologize to you for the times that that happens. And I'm working on it. Because I know that that's the secret ingredient, that nothing else will do. You know, also, it's just easy to be anxious about things that are going on in life or in circumstances within your own heart, your own personal well-being, that hold you back from living an outward-focused life to care for others. But you know, there's this amazing thing that happens when you start forcing yourself to love one another. Suddenly, your own problems don't seem so bad. See, the real problem here is that when we fail to love one another as a church, then we fail to be the church. Because that's the fundamental ingredient. That's the fundamental building block to construct a church that's going to do anything, that's going to make a difference. And that's why I'm here. I'm here to not just show up on Sunday mornings where there happens to be good snacks, just good enough, not too good. But there happens to be good snacks and friends that we enjoy their company and then go home. I want to make a difference in the lives of the people that are here and the people that aren't here yet. And the first thing to make that happen is to love one another well. You know, when we don't love each other well, it's like putting out a stinky candle as company's coming over and saying, "Hey, what do you think?" You laugh, but there is a company called the Stinky Candle Company, and they have all kinds of varieties of candles. You can get burrito-scented candles. Right? You can get skunk-scented candles. You can get exhaust-scented candles.
And you can get rest stops sent to campus. I'll let you imagine what that might be sent to like. So, they're on the internet. You can, it's proof that you can find anything online, right? Is it right there? And of course, if you have valued guests coming into your home, you're not going to light a joke candle. You want to make sure that things are tidy inside and that the smells they encounter are pleasant when they come in. And I haven't heard about any kind of overt frustration between relationships here at church. I don't know about anyone who's really stepped on any toes or been a bad neighbor to anyone here in church. So, and I hope if that does happen, that you find ways of dealing with that. And if it means coming to me and helping you work through issues, I want to be a part of that solution. But I think we are in danger of something that's actually a little more sinister. Even though we aren't actively hating each other, we are in danger of ambivalence. So that means I don't really care. Ambivalence is, whatever. It's nice that there are other people in this room with me, but I'm mostly here for the five people I know, and then I'll go home. See, when you are actively working against someone, when you have an enemy, then at least you care. Then there's that relationship that's at least holding you together that can be repaired. But when you're ambivalent, then I guess it doesn't matter whether they exist or not. And there's no relationship to be repaired or healed or enhanced or anything. And the point of being here, the fundamental building block, is to love one another. And how can you love someone who you're not connected with at all? And we are just not at a place as a church where we can get away with sliding in and sliding out. In fact, no church is at that place. No matter how big or how big their sanctuary or how many seats are in there or how big their bankroll is, there isn't a church that can get away with doing that, with just letting people slide in and slide out without meeting another soul. So that's not church. It becomes church when we love one another, when we love one another well. So, we need some solutions here, right? I'm not going to leave you hanging. And I've got three things. Three things you can do to love one another better so we grow the kingdom and grow this church so that this church can be here for a long, long time. So that all your kids can grow up here and grandkids can grow up here and be a part of what God is doing here. Because that's the goal. To create a sustainable community here that can continue to send the same kind of love that you've experienced out into the world. So, first, internalize Jesus' love for you. You need to really believe it. It can't just be something that we sing along together. And it can't just be something you tell your kids about. It has to be something that is real to you. Now, there's a little paradox there, because the best way to make Jesus' love real to someone is to show it with your own hands. That's what this love one another business is about, is to take the love that Jesus has shown you and to show it to others. And so that's why Jesus is telling this to his disciples, because they've got these tangible experiences. They've got these real memories of Jesus really doing things to show how much he loved them. And so they can say to him, oh, like that, the way that you loved me, I should show that love to one another. I can do that. We need to be that example for one another, so that we can experience the love of God, so that we then can internalize it and show it to others. So that's the first step, is internalize Jesus' love for you. Believe it for real. And if you don't believe it for real, talk to someone about how you don't believe it for real, because we are that kind of church. We are that kind of church where you can say to someone, I'm struggling with this, and they will not judge you. They will walk with you. The second thing to do is to be attentive to the needs of others. Now, again, that's really hard to do if you aren't in connection with others. If you aren't in relationship with others, then you can't know what they need. A few weeks ago, I had everyone write down a bunch of needs that they had, and I started reading through cards, and everyone was like, oh, people need all these things. That's people are going through real struggles, and people are struggling with their health, and people are struggling with their homework, you know, all these normal things. How did I not know that this was happening? Well, because we need to come into deeper levels of relationship. We need to connect and love one another. And love does stuff. Love is not just a warm feeling I feel for you. Love is an action. So, just pay attention in your conversations here as you get to know new people. But even better is to find avenues to know people even better. And then those things just pour out. I would suggest that you join something. Tomorrow night, we've got a new men's study that's starting up. There's a sign up over on the board. It's the one with Mr. T on it. And it's going to be a great chance to not only learn together, but to be together, to have opportunities to love one another in very manly ways. So, and there's already groups for women that are meeting on Thursday evenings and on Saturday mornings. I'm leading a Bible study on Thursday mornings. Like, if all these are like, I work too much, I can't ever be there. 7 a.m. Thursday morning, I am here for you. I am at Dun Brothers with some friends, reading the Bible and sharing our stories of how God is at work in our lives. So, if this is a priority, and so you find a spot. And if none of these work for you, come and talk to me, and we'll figure it out. Because you need to be connected to people other than walking in and walking out on a Sunday morning. It's just reality. You need to find a space where you can fall more in love with God because you've experienced that love from others. So, things to do. First, internalize Jesus' love for you. Second, be attentive to the needs of others. And third, be the evidence of Jesus' love. You need to be that evidence. You need to practice the love that you've received from Jesus. You've seen it at work as you read the Bible and as you've experienced it from people that have mattered to you. And now, that's our task, is to be the evidence that Jesus loves us. Now, why is it that children are so free to sing Jesus loves me, this I know? Because they've experienced the embrace of God through loving parents and grandparents and people in their lives. And they can sing it, and they can believe it. And it's somewhere along the way, we get jaded, and we forget. So we need to be those reminders for one another, even when it's hard. So, internalize Jesus' love for you, be attentive to the needs of others, and be the evidence of Jesus' love. We talk a lot here about how God is calling us to let our lives shine. And I have a gift for you, and I think we've got enough for one for everyone here. So if my ushers could come and pass these out. We have scented candles for you all. All right? On Sweet Smell Sunday. And so here's what it is. We've got the light of God within us. But then that has to change us. And it has to create lives that smell sweet to the world. This scented candle is something that you can light with your family or in your home, maybe in the morning before you head off to work and school. Say a prayer together, and as a reminder that because of the light of Christ, our lives should become something alluring, something sweet, because Jesus has given us that secret ingredient to love one another. Pray with me. God, we thank you for this great gift of your love that fills us and makes us whole. We pray that as your light shines on us, that it would transform us into people that love passionately and consistently, whose lives spill over with your joy and compassion. Help us be people that love deeply. In Jesus' name.